We want to welcome everybody back to Bedoe's Barbershop. I'm Bedoe, and this is another episode of Barbershop Talk. We're here today with my man, Ronnie Notch. We have a local artist here in our base. And we're here today just to get a couple of questions in, talk to my mans, you know what I'm saying? Let the world kind of get a feel of who he is.
But, you know, tell me what the word on who he is.
Basically, my thing is, my first question would be to you today. The name Ronnie Notch, is that the government or is it like an industry name?
Government now, but I wasn't born like that. I went ahead and switched it.
Okay.
You know, my real name is Ronnie. But when I was 14, I started DJing, and I realized I could make some money DJing, so I had this group with a couple of friends called Top Notch DJ.
Okay.
They all broke off and did their own thing, and then Notch stuck with me. I didn't like being called Top Notch, so I just took Ronnie, you know, my real name, and added Notch to it.
I know you did the song with I can't bring
like it.
Stick with it. Tell me what was like after you did that song?
Confusing.
Yeah.
But the best way to say it is that song did bring other business.
Okay.
For that I'm always thankful, but you know, for every situation, you know, it's going to be a learning experience in life.
Right.
And I was able to learn. Well, that sparked my interest in learning about publishing and learning as far as, okay, well, how do checks get broken up? You know, how is ownership determined? Copyright? How do you fill out, you know, register a song yourself and all these things? Because King knew everything. King was the one that knew how to do it. So, you know, I was learning from him. So the production aspect and things of that nature, like I had two deals, I think, by the time I made it to King and was really ignorant of the business, and I've had a chance to learn a lot, you know, with working with them and everything.
Okay, so it's like the learning experience.
I mean, don't get me wrong, you know, we still have a record out there, you know, it was 46 markets, 3 continents, you know what I mean? We did it independently.
Yeah.
But, you know, okay. I mean, it was definitely a learning thing.
Okay. Now, I also, you did a song with Katy Perry, Kiss the Girl.
The remix.
Okay. So you did that remix that you did. Now, how did that work? Tell me about that experience.
Bored at home.
Yeah.
And didn't have anyone to work with for real. So, like, what I'll do, you know, I'll just, if I have a connect at a label, if I can find a website that's acapellas, I just work on, you know, acapellas and make a remix.
Mm-hmm.
And that one so happened to work with MTV. They did like a Super Sweet 16 episode.
Okay.
And I knew a couple of people, so I sent the track and they liked it. So that was, and actually, that was my first, what's called a sync license, you know, TV placement that I ever had. I ended up getting it on my own. So, you know, when it came time to have a conversation with managers, music supervisors, people that say they play the music, you know, it was kind of hard to have that conversation with me. And you couldn't do what I already did for myself.
The way that I did it in Ohio was, I was in the middle of nowhere, so that forced me to get up every day and work, stay up late and work, you know.
And work at that time was internet, so I would research, like, the core DJs had a website back then. A lot of people would hit the message boards. I took in the email address that I saw that I could have, and build that up and stay in contact. And when I got home to St. Louis, it was like everything slowed down because, like, the same people that were working before I left were in the exact same position they were when I got back. And that's not really knocking, it's just to say, like, it made me feel like I didn't have to work as hard. So I just, you know, it was kind of like a bad thing coming. I mean, it wasn't bad coming back, don't get me wrong. Like, I had to work in a lot. Yeah, it was kind of like you could show up at a club and someone puts your hands on.
Now, saying that, what artists are you looking for to work with out here? A lot of names, got a lot of artists. You got a lot of independent artists,
like local people.
I mean, more than normal, so locally, I mean, like, industry-wise. Is there somebody out here that you are really looking forward to?
A big person that was on my list was Twista, and I just got a chance to work with him a couple of months ago. Well, we did our work in December, and we haven't released a song yet, but that was one of the ones that was on my list. Next on my list is Nas. I think that may happen before the end of the year.
Okay. So what artists are you currently working with as of now?
Right now, the only artist I'm working with is Kyle Andrew. there's another female artist. Well, there's a female, I kind of lose a gap. Okay. But there's a female artist that I'm thinking about working with out of Chicago. Figuring out if it's going to work or not. College, young kid, 20 years old. This passion, I did a production deal with him in 2012. I just kind of just work with him and develop him. You know, this whole thing is a marathon. I'm trying to get out of here and run it like it's a sprint. You know, 100 yard dash, 40 yard dash, you're going to lose. You know, you got to get a marathon with me.
Right.
And now he's at that point where I said, I'm going to go in my pocket and invest. Open this kid. So, you can't grab all. No, he's on these other arms. And, you know, and the only reason I say that is because, you know, I like rap artists. You know, for a while, like 3 years, I would not work with a rap artist. It was just like everything I was doing, nobody wanted a rap artist. Or it took too much, or I couldn't get a rap artist to understand that you can't take my production and go put it on the mixtape. Because neither one of us is going to see any money. And in the end, you may see money before I do, because I don't get a dime off of what you make off of the show. So we got to do something that makes sense business-wise. If we're not going to promote it, that's the way it's going to reach a million people, 100,000 people. What's the point of you doing, giving you a track that I could sell for profit for this mixtape, but you're not going to make a dollar off of it. So, but yeah, I'm definitely working with Colin Brewer. And I hate to say it, but the single is a song called All Makes Sense, featuring the artist from here. Same with Orleans, people were saying I didn't work with artists from here. And Colin Brewer's not from here, he's from Arlington, Virginia.
Okay.
But at the same time, it's like I found someone here that had the quality and the business mind. And the same Orleans came in, whether they had all my former rights organization stuff done. This how I was supposed to publish it, and I got this.
Right.
You know, that impressed me as much as his verse did.
So. Right.
I had a rapper sing me a song, and a lot. The song was titled, that I can't touch, but it was, I'm an exclude of these excluders. You know, I'm an F these agents. And he was like, yeah, now I have to send that out to these TV shows. I'm sure they like it for a club scene. And it's like, I'm gonna send this song on my reputation that I worked up with these people.
Right.
And that's the title for, you know, a major network. You know, I'm sending that to a major network. So what I mean to say that is always have a good consumer-friendly product. There's a difference between the demographic that you're trying to reach and your consumer and your consumer target. Because let's say you make music for like the streets or whatever. I'm not saying you do, but you know, let's say you make music for the streets, but let's say the streets are only going to buy 7% of your music market, whereas everybody else is going to buy 83% or 93% of your music. But they don't want to buy just what the streets like. They want to buy stuff that they feel good to, that they like, stuff that they don't mind playing from the parents. You know what I mean? You got to always put that into it. I'm not saying, you know, water down your content or music, but you know what I'm saying? Like, you got to make sure that it's always consumer first and yourself last. Let's say restaurant, the customer is always right or whatever. It's the same thing with fans. The fan is always right.
Right.
Even though in music you can tell the fan what they're supposed to like, but they're not supposed to like. And that's just by giving them the same thing over and over and over again. A lot of artists mess it up by giving the dust of a fan. It's a lot of them, it's just about humbling yourself too. Some people do that with fans.
Right.
I get emails every day saying, yeah, my buzz is growing, you know, I got a good following. Well, what do you mean following? You know, to me a good following is 200,000 people.
Right.
But to them a good following is 2,023 people talking about their music on Facebook.
Right.
You know what I mean? If they're 2,023 people at $10 a sale, still isn't gonna be able to pay, you know, that didn't pay my bills for a month.
Right.
So I still gotta be able to look at it as, okay, well, what is a following? How do you determine a good following? How do you feel that following? And if you've been doing the same thing over and over again for years and you still got the same 20, 23, maybe 50 people by now, you gotta change something. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So you got some kinds of stuff in the way for the passion keeps you there. They're passionate. No, I'm gonna give them what I want to give them. Okay. You're gonna give those same 23, 50 people exactly what you've been giving them. Then even that's when you meet 50 people on your side. And then you got nobody. You know? Attention span is very short. When we dropped Pickwick in 2007, the life of the song. song is on the 90 days program. And it's definitely not 90 days no more. You know, we didn't have, Facebook was out, but we still attacked MySpace. Twitter definitely wasn't that many days on stream, right? It was 15 second videos. And what I'm doing now with my artist, I'm going back to the basics. Like when I was 14, I used the street team promotions for like No Limit, Priority, Rap a Lot, you know. If you saw posters around in the city and all that stuff, odds are it was me asking people for a ride so that I could go get the posters up and everything. And I feel, you know, granted the industry has changed, you know, the first part of changing when you have the Gordon CD, the Ian Thompson, the Bunny CD, right, and the changes in the people and everything, so forth and so on. But at the same time, when I put a poster up and people were looking, even when I did that, if I saw a poster on the CD store or just on an abandoned building, you know, in St. Louis, I remember seeing it. And now everybody has some kind of graphic on Facebook about the internet, about this ability, this is what they do. So how are you setting this up apart from everybody else? You look like you're awful. Like, I don't get the time to listen to you, or if you have an interview and I don't get the chance to listen to your interview or watch your interview, you look like everybody else that I just saw on the internet. That's why I love when you know, a chance to do an interview, because right, a lot of people don't look at it as a chance to do something. I'm not saying do an interview with anybody. Mr. A is just Mr. A, right? You know, but at the same time, it's like when I go to the yeah, exactly. And shoot, I mean, to be honest, that was one of the ways that we broke that record. Basically, if people don't realize it, Mr. A was there from the very beginning of the block. You know, wherever we were, it seemed like he was always there with the camera. That stuff helped, right? Because you look back on it, you sent the stuff out, you sent the press reels and demo reels, it was all this footage, all this picture, and it was more than just us giving music. You know, essentially, when you're an artist, you gotta break it down to bottom line. I'm out there, I'm sorry, but like, if you're an artist, you gotta look at it like this. If you have a song, you have this product, you're basically a salesperson. You're either a salesperson or a homeless man. Because you're asking people, no matter how you look at it, give me. Or, you know, no matter what you're saying, give me. This, but, you know, it's all about what you're asking them to give you in exchange for what you'll give them. And it's about how good your product is. And everybody else is saying, give me too. So if someone else is saying, give me in a better way than you, that's why they win. It's all about how you're asking. Now, the way the success comes is you can show them that it's an even exchange, or they'll end up getting something better than what they're going to give. No man is going to say, I'm giving you $100 and I'm giving you $10. I got very few people that are going to turn that down because you're getting more than what you're giving. You know what I mean? It's got to be the same thing with your music. You know, if you're honest, you know, with yourself and people who don't even know you, my product is better than this $9.99 or even $0.99 you're going to spend for the single. It's better than you win. You can't prove that and stand by it and hit play. That's how people either, they may spend $0.99 with you one time, but they're not going to come back the one time that you put something out. Just, oh man, I shouldn't pay for this at all. Right. You know, so. That, and maybe you can tell the plug or whatever, but, develop a curriculum, music production, and audio engineering at Homestead. Myself and Ira DeWitt know that because we really, you know, that's something we need to talk about. We got a lot of artists, producers, and entertainers out here. You know, I have equipment, the microphones, the mixing boards, the beat machines, the software, all that stuff. They have no idea how to really use it, or they get into the industry and don't have any idea of how to really run a successful label, be a successful artist, manager, all these things,
right?
And a lot of people, you know, shy away from going to programs as well. Okay, well, I'm gonna spend money, but what's gonna happen with me after I complete this degree? So it was important for us to do that with an accredited university, right? Because you get to take that chance for a certificate or accredited hours. You can go anywhere in the world or the country because UMS was recognized everywhere. Right? You know what I mean? And it's affordable. So, you know, that was one of the big things that we did, a lot of this stuff. And, you know, we teach the class, like I actually teach the music production class. She teaches intro to music business. When you look at Missouri, this is factual. You look at the state of Missouri and even the region around, like some of the United States, notifies the only functional label that turns up a profit. You know, you got line items, you got genuine, you got top 10 records, number one records, platinum records. Billboard, and then you got Grammy as well. You look at other labels, like the next closest label is probably Tech N9ne and Strange Music, you know, in terms of turning around. So you get these kids that don't have to go to Full Sail or California, New York, and fight for an internship
right.
that they'll never get. And they're able to get this experience, this education, and this internship with someone who's doing it every day.
Right.
You know what I mean? So that was important as well. So, and that's good, whether you're an OMSA student or a non-OMSA student, we made it available to everyone.
So if, how to get in contact with you? Check you out. Work with us, work with us.
I got a website, RonnieNotchMusic.com. I'm off Twitter. Eventually I'll be off Facebook and I'll be off Instagram. I feel like a lot of those things are just more of a distraction than they are being helpful. There's a time I can make money off of Facebook and I can make money off Twitter. It's just over distraction.
Right.
If I'm going to be on there just playing around, that's time I can go up and spend time with my son and my wife. So it's just time to, you know, bring it all back and just get back to what we're supposed to do. Just, you know, a lot of us celebrate before we do the
work. Right.
And I was included, you know, it's time to get back to it.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, appreciate having you, man.
Well, I definitely appreciate it.
You know, good seeing you meeting for the first time. Yeah. Everybody, I'm glad you came through.
I want to check out some of your music. No, I mean, in 05, we had a phone conversation because somebody hooked it up with us.
Yeah, they got on
top of the year, this is very cool. We had a series of conversations down there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know what I mean? It's one of those things
where
I love to work with, you know, I've sent tracks to you recently, and now it's like I don't even have a gap for them. You know what I mean?
Right.
One of those things where, I was gonna bring him here for a show and we figured out how much it was gonna cost to bring him here just to be able to work with him, you know what I mean? I saw him here in 2001, he came to Faith Evans and somebody else and old River Club, I think it's called Rising Now. But I saw him perform then and it's just like, you know, there's nothing like it.
Right. Well, we wanna say we wanna thank you again. This is another episode of Barbershop Talk. I am Bedoe. See you next time. Appreciate it.